Discuss about independency and conditional independency. So why we are discussing about all these? So we had already seen that how to compute joint protein mass function that I had already discussed in the one of previous lecture. So generally, if you are having two random variable, then there would be no any issue. Easily you can compute joint protein mass function how using multiplication rule or what we call it chain rule. So how we compute joint protein mass function of any two random variable x and y? We compute that in such a way, suppose we are observing x first, so that means simply we know the prior distribution of x, and afterward we multiply the prior distribution of x with conditional distribution of y given x. After x we are observing y, that means x happens to be condition on x happens to be partial information for observing y. So that's why we are able to compute joint protein mass function of x and y in that process. Okay, so it is very simple that we can compute like this way. But if you talk about generalization of this multiplication rule in order to compute joint protein mass function, suppose we are having more than two random variables like x, y, z. So again, if you are willing to calculate joint protein mass function of x and y, so again we have to generalize this rule, and in the same framework by applying the multiplication rule we can find joint protein mass function of x and y. But question here, in the process of finding joint protein mass function, the representation would be little bit complicated. How you can see it yourself here. Suppose again I am saying that it is not like that, I am always taking x first. So it depends upon the nature of problem. The nature of problem will decide which random variable you are observing first. So again I am taking here x. We are suppose x we are observing first, so that means we know the prior distribution of x. Then after x we are observing y. So what would happen? So here we will have not prior distribution of y, we will have a conditional distribution of y given x. So for each x we try to observe y with certain probability, so that's why we will have conditional distribution of y given x. So here you can see that in first two we have already observed x and y. After x and y then we try to observe z. So how we can find property of mass function of z? So we are finding it property mass function of z once we had already observed x and y. So we say that it is conditional property of z given x and y. We say like given x and y. So here this notation you can see there is a little bit complicated. You can see it is having some complex representation. Why such complex representation is coming here? Okay, here given x and y we are writing like this way. So if you focus on this representation, it looks a little bit complicated. Why not we simplify this complexity? So how we can simplify this complexity? By introducing here one new variant of independency that we are calling it conditional independency. So we can simplify it further here. Suppose that conditioning z given x and y, it is just it is having dependency with respect to y only. That means given y, z is independent of x. So that scenario we can take it. So if we take this scenario that given x, given y, z is independent of x, that we are calling it conditional independency. So for that perspective the representation it becomes simple. It just becomes conditional protein mass function of z given y of z. Okay, given y. So simple, we are getting a simple representation. So here we introduce here conditional, the concept of conditional independency. Due to that we are getting this simple representation. You can easily see that this representation, this conditional distribution is simpler than this one. So here through this conditional independency we come across to see this one, and due to that the representation of joint protein mass function of x, y and z, it is taking a simple form like this way. It is talking about prior property of x. That means x you are observing first, after x you are observing y, so given x. So that's why you are writing conditional protein mass function of x given y, after you are trying to observe z given y. So here, what situation we observe? Here we observe one chain kind of situation. That means there is a proper sequential chain kind of situation we observe here, given y. Okay, the chain. So that means situation is coming like that. First we observe x, then we observe y, then we observe z. So it is a one kind of sequential approach, what we call it. So there is a proper order. So first we observe x, afterward we are trying to observe y, afterward we try to observe z. So if you see in this sequence, so given y, z is independent of x. So here given y, so easily you can see that we are calling it conditional independency. So here it would be given. So if you are trying to find conditional probability of z given x and y, so once y is given to you, it would be independent of x. So it would be just equal to density of, so probability mass function of z given y, only y. It would be independent of x. So due to conditioning over y, it would be independent of x. So that situation we try to see that. So this situation we are calling it here, through this pattern we can say simply, if you don't say that given y, simply we can say that x and z both are dependent, because you can see there is how you got z. You got it from x. X is going to y, and after that y is going to z. So that's why directly we can say that x and z, there are clear dependency in this sequential rule. Okay, you can easily see that if you are start from x, definitely you will arrive at z. So there is a clear dependency. Likewise, y and z is having clear dependency. But if suppose we are saying that suppose we are able to observe y, okay, here first, so given y, z would be independent of x. So that we are calling it conditional independence. So that scenario we will take it in general and we will discuss further. Okay, so this we are calling it, all these are part of introducing conditioning through independency or dependency through conditioning approach. So all about that, we try to find joint probability mass function of various random variable or multiple random variable. Okay, and next week onward we will start function of two or more than two random variable, and there again we have to find the distribution of those function. Okay, that we will call it derived random variable. Okay, so that in the process of computing distribution of derived random variable, you have to be very much clear about the notion of independency, the notion of conditioning, and all these things you have to be clear. So how we can introduce conditioning in order to simplify what distribution of the derived random variable. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would like to introduce the notion of independency. That means if we are taking any two random variable, when we will call those two random variable would be independent. So it is very simple that it is derived from the notion of independency of event. That we know that when two events happen to be independent, that the happening of one is not affecting the happening of other, then simply we can say that those two events would be independent to each other. Likewise, if we are having two random variable, if observation of one random variable is not affecting the observation of other random variable, then simply we can say that those two are independent to each other. Okay, so same criteria would come, and after that we will discuss about a weaker version of dependency that will come through conditional independence. Okay, so we will introduce notion of conditional independence. So that what is happening, that if you are having two random variable, then those may be dependent. Okay, if you just try to see that those may be dependent, if suppose another random variable, we have already observed another random variable, the third random variable, then from the perspective of the observation of third random variable, we can say that first and second are independent, so that their conditional independency is coming. Afterward, we will discuss various examples from conditional probability mass function and conditional expectation, because we need to solve various problems in order to understand further a lot. Okay, so coming to first part of today's lecture regarding independency, how we can describe it. As I mentioned that we have to discuss it from various perspective, from the distribution perspective. Okay, so if the occurrence of the conditioning event tells nothing about the value of random variable, then we say that the random variable X, it would be independent of the conditioning event A. Okay, so how we mathematically say that? That means we are having a random variable X and we are having an event A. Suppose we have already observed A, but that observation of A is not affecting the occurrence of or occurrence of possible value of X, then simply we can say that X is independent of A, because in the process of defining conditional probability, first we had defined conditional probability of a random variable X condition on an event. So from that segment we are defining here independency. Okay, so later we will generalize it for two random variable as well. Okay, A is very general kind of thing. A may come from any kind, A may be any kind of event. So no, this kind of conditioning we had already introduced, conditional random variable, conditional probability mass function we had already introduced. So from that segment we are defining like this way. So mathematically how we define notion of independency? So we suppose we are having a random variable X and an event A. So we will say that if the joint occurrence of X, random variable X, that joint occurrence of random variable X and A can be calculated, the probability of joint occurrence of these two can be calculated as the product of the probability of occurrence of the respective one. That means joint occurrence of X equal to small x and A is equal to product of probability that X is observing, random variable X is observing this value times probability of A. So it is just simple coming that if you are computing joint probability just by multiplying the prior probability, then we say that these two would be independent, X and A both would be independent to each other. Okay, like yes, here further, if you are willing to write in term of probability mass function of X and probability of A, then you can write like this way. Further, if you generalize it, then we know that joint probability mass function we denote it by like this way, and we say that occurrence of A first is not going to affect the occurrence of observation of possible value of X. So what does it mean? That means simply we say that the conditional probability mass function is just equal to prior probability mass function of X. So in that situation we say that the partial information which is given about A is not going to affect the occurrence of X. So it is not affecting anymore. Okay, that's why we say that X is independent of A. So either you go for notion of independency between X and A, this or these both are equivalent to each other. Both you can derive, if you know this one from there you can derive two, and if you know two from two you can derive one. So both implies and implied by, simply by implication is there. So easily either you go for this notion of independency or you go for this notion of independence. So both are equivalent to each other. Okay, now further, if you talk about one example I am taking it first. So consider the two independent tosses of a fair coin. Okay, and there we are defining a random variable X as a counting the number of heads. Okay, and this one X is a random variable, so X is observing value, what value? It is observing three value. Either X would be zero, that means no head. Either X will observe one, that means one head. Either X will observe two, that means two heads. Okay, so these are the possible observation of X that we can. No, okay, and X is having a distribution. Simply what would be the distribution of X? You know that it is counting number of heads. So here simply it is a binomial distribution with parameter n equal to 2, that number of total trials, and probability of success. You are taking fair coin, so probability of success would be 0.5. so everything is given to you. So easily you can say that X is binomially distributed. Okay, and n is equal to 2. So it is a binomial distribution with parameter 2 and probability of success 0.5. okay, now coming to discuss further, that we put conditioning over A, that we are observing A first, that what is A? A is talking about, it is the event that number of head is even, number of head is even. So what are the even head? So even head, number of head is even, that means even number is 0 or 2. Okay, this situation it is talking about. So it is A is talking about this one. Okay. So simply if I ask what is the conditional probability mass function of X without any condition. So without any condition, it is what? Distributed binomially. So through binomial distribution X equal to 0. If you're taking value of probability mass function at X equal to 0, it is 1 by 4. And that means both times we are getting tail in the toss, in both tosses. So 1 by 2 into 1 by 2, 1 by 4 you are getting it. Now for X equal to 1, it would be 2 choose 1 times 1 by 2. Okay. Times 1 by 2. So it would be simply after solving you will get 1 by 2 and this one. Simply I would like to say that here X is having binomial distribution. What is the parameter? Parameter is n equal to 2. That means we are performing 2 number of prime. And what is the probability of success of each trial? It is 1 by 2. So that's way from there you can easily you can derive the distribution of this one. Generic framework, you know that it is talking about n choose k p to the power k, p is the probability of success, times 1 minus p, that one is probability of failure, times n minus k. This is the binomial distribution, we know that. Here n equal to 2 and p equal to 1 by 2. So that's where you are getting explicit form of the distribution of X. So this is the distribution of X. Now likewise, if you are willing to calculate probability of A, event A, so it is taking just how many value? It is taking head is number of head is even. Okay, number of head is even. So what are the situation? If you try to compute the probability of A, so you have to look, in order to compute the probability of A, you have to look pre-images of A. So 0 is what? 0 is having pre-image tail, that means both time we are getting head, and 2 is having pre-image head. So what is probability of tail? Probability of tail is 1 by 4 and probability of head is 1 by 4. So that means A is having just 2 outcome, or pre-image of A also you can say that pre-image of A is having 2 outcome, head tail. So just sum the probability of these outcome, that means you try to look A happen through these outcomes, so you have to single out, and that's the probability of A would be what? It would be out of total possible 4 outcome, 2 are contained in A, so that's the probability of A would be what? 2 by 4, and hence it would be 1 by 2. So this is the probability of A. So we are having every information. Afterward we will try to come up with conditional probability mass function of X given A. So we know from the definition of conditional probability mass function of X given A. So how we define it? So this I had already defined several times. So again, you can recall. So the conditional probability of mass function of X given A, it would be what? Probability mass function of X. If X is coming from the event A, then it is just we have to normalize it by probability of A when X is coming from the event A. That means either X is 0 or 2. And X, if X is not coming from A, in that case, the conditional probability mass function of X given A, it would be 0. So that we had already seen. Okay. So from here, we can talk about the conditional probability mass function of X. What would be? It would be when X is equal to 0, it would be 1 by 2. When X equal to 1, it would be 1 by 2. And when X equal to 1, it would be 0. So because 1 is not in event A, so that's your probability would be 0. The probability mass function for X equal to 1, it would be 0. So this is the what we call it conditional probability mass function of X given A. So easily we can say that this conditional probability mass function is not equal to prior probability mass function of X. Okay, so simply we can claim that it is X and A are not independent from the, it is not satisfying the notion of independency. So simply we can say that X and A are not independent. What does it mean? Means X and A are dependent. Here we say that there is a dependency between X and the random variable X and the event. Okay, dependent. Now I will talk about notion of independency with respect to two random variable X and Y. We had discussed in the previous slide regarding notion of independency between a random variable X and one event A. Now here situation is more generalized. So suppose we are having two random variables x and y from the same experiment, then we will say that these two would be independent if we are able to write joint probability mass function of x and y as a product of individual probability mass function of x and y. Then simply we can claim that the two random variables happens to be independent to each other. Okay, if we are able to write like this way. So here easily you can say that if two random variables happens to be independent, then the computation of joint probability mass function is very easy. Just you come up with marginal probability mass function and multiply those two and you will get the joint probability mass function. Now there is another notion of dependency for two random variable. How? That means if you suppose you are observing y first, then does if the observation of y first is not affecting the probability mass function of x, then simply we say that these two are independent to each other. So here we are observing y first, and apart from that observing y first, it is not going to affect the observation of x, probability of observation of x, and hence we can say that these two x and y happen to be independent to each other. So that means conditional probability of x is just equal to prior probability of x. So here, once you are put observing a first, it is not going to alter the probability mass function of x. So that's why we say that x and y are independent to each other. Okay, so we'll take a few example here. So and also let us deduce few result here. Suppose x and y happen to be independent random variable, then even if you are willing to compute expectation, it is very simple to compute. So if you are willing to compute expectation of product of x and y, we know that x and y are random variable, and if you multiply two random variable, it becomes a new random variable as a function of two random variable. Okay, so if you are willing to compute expectation of this one, it is very much simple that it is just what product of expectation of respective random variable. If someone is willing to see this proof, it is very simple, very simple. How? We know that here condition is given that x and y are independent to each other. So go to find definition of expectation. So we are finding this expectation of x into y. So what? It is function of x and y. So how will define expectation of x and y? It is coming through like here random variable z is what? It is product of x and y. Simply you can call it. Okay. Then if you talk about what is the distribution of this one z, so here we will go through expected rule. So z is actually function of x, y. So how z will vary, the distribution of z, it will characterize by the joint distribution of x, y. So that through expected rule, we have to look into this one is function of x, y, and we have to distribution of x and y. That means joint distribution of x and y. So here joint distribution of x, y will come from the expected value rule. Okay, joint distribution of x and y. But we know that what we know, we and here summation we have to take with respect to x, y both, because here both are varying together. So we are taking a summation with respect to both. So what we do further here, we know that here x and y are independent to each other. So easily the joint probability mass function would be factored into individual marginal probability mass function. So that concept we are applying it here. So we are writing here this expectation of x into y, and we are taking summation with respect to x and y both. That means double summation is coming here. So, x times y times probability of x, probability mass function of x into probability mass function of y because of independence nature of x and y. Okay, so we do little bit simplification here. We are trying to write x, all x together, so and the corresponding probability mass function x times probability mass function of x. And here we are taking summation with respect to x only, and then we are writing y with probability mass function of y, and here we are taking summation with respect to all y. Okay, so easily we can see that what does it talk about? It is just expectation of x, and this one is expectation of y. You can easily see that. Okay, and hence we got this result. Expectation of product of x, y equal to expectation of x into expectation y. provided that x and y are independent. If x and y are not independent, you can't get this result. There would be some covariance term would come here. One covariance term would come here. That trend. Okay. Likewise, also you can generalize it. You can generalize this result. That means if x and y happen to be independent of each other, yes. Yeah, it is very simple that just recall expected value rule that what I had mentioned. So here you can write it z equal to what? It is function of x and y, and the expected value rule what I had told that in case of function of one random variable. So suppose your like call it w, you are taking function of a random variable x. And if I am asking to find the expectation of W, how you find expectation of W? There were two approaches to find expectation of W. Are you able to recall that expected value rule? Okay, from there it will come. Let me deduce it again. So, let me use this space. So suppose we are taking W as a function of. So that's, it is just generalization of same thing, that expected value rule I had defined for function of one variable. So if you are willing to compute expectation of W, there are two approach. I had mentioned that one approach that what you do through this function, you can find individually expectation, protein mass function of W. You can come up with explicit form of protein mass function of W, and then multiply each W with the corresponding protein mass function of W. Okay, so here you need to know explicit form of the protein mass function of W, and you are taking summation with respect to X. Another approach was provided by, you can call this one is the definition approach, definition of expectation. Another one was expected value rule. What we do here, we know that in place of W, we write it W as a function of X. W is what? Each W is having a pre-image X. So W is actually G of X. And here it is, we are multiplying G of X with protein mass function of X. Because G is function of X, so that's where we are coming with. And that simplification, that notation, I had already explained how we are getting this one. These two are equal to each other. So are you able to recall this representation? Anyone? You know, same situation is coming here. X into Y. What is this one? This one is function of X and Y. It is a function of X and Y. Then definitely, if it is a function of X and Y, then how we describe distribution of X and Y together, simultaneously? We describe it by the joint protein mass function of X and Y. So it is a function of X, Y. So here, what will come here? Here, joint protein mass function of X and Y will come here. Is it clear or not? Your doubt is clear or not? Yeah. So that's why. Because X into Y is a function of X, Y. So that's where. So just simply you can say that it is directly coming from expected rule. So the second approach. It is a situation for function of one variable. This one is situation for function of two variable. Likewise, you can generalize for function of three variable, four variable, likewise. Okay, fine. Any other doubt? Okay, fine. So going further, I was saying here the same thing. That this result also easily you can derive. How? There is a beautiful result that if x, y happens to be independent, then it is simply implying that if you are raising x to a function of x and raising y to a function of y, then the notion of independency, it will continue. That g of x would be independent of h of y. Due to that, easily you can also find the expectation of product of g of x and h of y. Easily you can find. So it is very interesting. You can see all these. So these results are helping to find expectation in the independent notion. Okay, now situation is coming that if suppose x and y are not independent, that means they are dependent, then what will happen? In that case, the expectation of x and y, it would be not equal to just product of corresponding expectation. One another term would come, that would come as a variance, covariance of x and y, covariance term. So everyone, we had already discussed about variance, notion of variance. So variance, notion of variance is talking, you can say that it is talking about covariance of x with itself. So it is notion of variance we are defining as a expectation of a square mean deviation, a square of mean deviation. So that means every random possible random variable we deviate it by the mean, and after that we do a square, and after that we are taking expectation. So we are defining this, we are term we are calling variance, but it is talking about variability of x. Okay, but suppose we are having two random variable, then relatively how these two random variable vary together, so their covariance term is coming. In short, you can write it COV. So COV, how we define it between x and y? So here in the notion of covariance, you can see it is talking about expectation of product of two random variable. First one is x minus expectation of x, and second is also x minus expectation of x. So it is like this way. In the same framework, we can define covariance. What would be covariance? Here we are having two random variable, so it is talking about expectation of product of mean deviation of x times mean deviation of y. So this one, this term we are calling it covariance. It is just what we call it generalization of variance. So if you are having one random variable, then you are seeing variability of x with respect to x itself, and covariance is variability of x with respect to y as well. So that term we are calling it covariance. So this one is the notion of covariance. So same here, and this is having this formula. And if you are willing to derive it, result is very simple. What you have to do, play with this expectation of x into y. So how you will define expectation of x into y? It will define in the same framework, that it would be defined as expectation of so it is like just we not as it will define like this way. It is defined as a summation over x into y, over x into y, summation of x and y, summation of x y times joint distribution of x into y. Here you can't factor the joint distribution x y directly in term of what we call it in term of product of corresponding prior distribution. You have to deal with conditional distribution. That means here simply it would be factor. If you talk about factor of this one, it would be factor into x in distribution of x times distribution of y given x of y given x. It will affect either you go through this way, or you can observe y first, then you go through another way. Okay, so that technique would be what through that you can easily prove that. But here that approach would be a little bit complicated. What you do, better way is that you start with this, you start with definition of covariance, and after that you will get this relation easily. You will get this relation. So this one is one definition approach. It would be a little bit complicated. So what you do, just start with the definition of covariance and try to simplify. Because here you can do algebra here. Here you can't do algebra further. Here if you are writing in this way further, then again you will face some complicacy. You have to apply various rule of expectation. Okay, law of iterated expectation, other will come here. But here what you do, if you see in the definition of covariance, just you have to do algebra within the expectation operator. After that, just you keep on applying the expectation operator. Okay, so this approach is very simple, that start with the definition of covariance and you will get this result. Take it as a homework or practice purpose and easily you can derive this result. There is no much complexity is here. Okay, you can derive, you can play with this result. Start with definition of covariance and from there deduce this relation. Okay, so we will talk about few example. Afterward we will discuss conditional expectation. So here we are discussing about expectation of number of a student who got grade A. Okay, so how we can find expectation of such a student? So question is coming like this way. So your probability class is having 300 students and each student is having probability 1 by 3. Each student is having probability 1 by 3 of getting grade A independently of any other student. Okay, there is no dependence. It is not like that, that a student will get help from other student in order to get grade A. There is no such situation. We are not taking such situation. Okay, now then question is coming that we have to find the expectation of x, where x is talking the number of students that get any grade A. We have to find that expectation. So how we can find the expectation? So it is very simple to solve this problem. The approach is like this was, first we have to introduce a Bernoulli random variable. How we introduce with respect to each trial. So, okay, so what is that Bernoulli random variable? Xi, we are calling it Xi is the Bernoulli random variable. It is defined in such a way that Xi is observing value 1 when ith student is getting grade A. But if ith student is not getting grade A, then Xi would be 0. So this Bernoulli random variable, just we design it as in order to solve this problem. Then X would be a binomial random variable. And it is composed from these Bernoulli random variable x1 to xn, because n is equal to 300, it is given here. This is the n. So here what we do, we with respect to each trial, each student, with respect to each student, we are calling it a trial. Either, so if you talk about each student, then regarding each student, you can say that easily you can describe it by Bernoulli trial. How? That each student either will get a grade A or will not get grade A. So it is, that's binary situation is there. So that's where we are introducing binary random variable. Okay, after that here if you are introducing Bernoulli random variable, then we know that it is very much easy to compute expectation of Bernoulli random variable and also variance of Bernoulli random variable. What is the expectation of Bernoulli random variable? It is just equal to probability of success, and we know that what is the probability of success? It is given 1 by 3. That means with probability 1 by 3 that ith Bernoulli random variable will get 1. Okay, so this is probability of success, it is already given to you. So that's why expectation of Xi is 1 by 3. Each Xi is 1 by 3. Okay. Likewise, if you are willing to calculate variance, it is what? Variance is nothing, just product of probability of success and probability of failure. Probability of success is 1 by 3. Probability of failure is what? 2 by 3. That means 1 minus 1 by 3. 2 by 3. So that's why simplify it. It is 2 by 9. So that one is what variance. So we got the variance of Xi as well. So we are having both information. So we are interested to find the expectation of X. What it is counting? Total number of success. Total number of success, that generally we call it binomial random variable. So here X also, we can decompose X into binomial random variable like this way. Okay. So here if you are willing to find expectation of X, so it is very simple that each Xi is related with a trial. Okay, so each trial is independent of another trial. So that's why we can say that x1 is independent of x2, x2 is independent of x3, and likewise you can say that pairwise independence, you can observe it here. So if you are willing to find the expectation of X, so what would be expectation of X? It is very simple that you can see here, expectation is just computable commutative with respect to summation. this expectation just apply over this summation, and this when you apply expectation over this summation, that expectation it will go inside to find the expectation of ith Bernoulli random variable. And we know that what is the value of this one. This one is 1 by 3. Okay. So it is what? It is taking a fixed value. So we can take here from here 1 by 3 out of summation. Then only we will have summation I vary from 1 to how many student we are having? 300 student summation. Summation of this one. So what is summation of this one? It is that means you are summing 1 to 300. So one how many times? 300 times. 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 300 times. So what would be that value? That would be value would be 300. 300, and here you are dividing by 3. So expected number would be 100. That these 100 student will get grade A. What is the expected number of a student? Those will get grade A 100. If probability of success is 1 by 3, then that is the answer. Okay. Likewise, there is a similar question related with hat problem. So what is hat problem? It is very much similar to that. You suppose there are n number of people. Okay, and they throw their hats in a box. Put their hats in a box. Okay, and then each one picks one hat at random from that box. So what is the expected number, expected value of x? X is what? The number of people that get back their own hat. Okay, they are not getting hit of other hat of other, they are getting hat of their itself. Okay, so we have to find the expectation of that. Again here x would be binomially distributed. Okay, so we have to introduce here again design a Bernoulli random variable with respect to each trial. So what is that Bernoulli random variable? So here xi is talking about, xi will take equal to 1 if ith person is getting back his or her own hat. Okay, otherwise xi will take 0. Then tell me what is the probability of success. Anyone would like to highlight what will with what probability that person will ith person will get back his or her own hat? Anyone would like to say that what would be probability of success here? Anyone? Here no information is given here, so by 1 by n simple, yeah, simple, nice, simple uniform law applied here, and then probability of success is what? It is 1 by n. Why? Because of equally likely situation or uniform law. So due to that x, you got xi, that means n number of random variable, you got the probability of success. So easily you can compute expectation of each xi, that would be what? Equal to probability of success equal to 1 by n. And also you can compute variance, what would be product of probability of success and probability of failure. So that it is coming like this way. In the same framework you can decompose x in the sum of, as a sum of n number of Bernoulli random variable, and hence easily you can compute expected value of x. It is similar problem what we had already discussed, that means it is equal to 1. The in average, what we call it, we simply say that the expected value of x is 1. In average, one person will get one hat. So that simply we say that. Now we are trying to discuss about here now notion of conditional independency. What is meaning of this? So we had already seen the notion of independency. So here we will introduce conditional independency. How it is coming? Sometimes two random variables might not be independent, or that term we also call it marginally independent. However, they can become independent after we observe third random variable. If you are observing something another one, then with respect to that third one, both would be independent to each other. So here directly I will talk about, suppose random variable x is what we will say, that random variable x is conditionally independent of random variable y given random variable z. If random variable of probability mass function of x given y and z we define as a probability like this way, And further, what is it is happening that it is just independent of y. Given z, it is independent of y. That means you are willing to compute the conditional probability mass function of x given y z. It is nothing, just it is equal to conditional probability mass function of x given z. That means there is no influence of y on the occurrence of x or on the observation of possible value of x. So that's why we say that given z, x and y are independent to each other. So vice versa also for y also you can define it like this way. So simply further, if you are willing to say in intuitive way, you can say that the having knowledge of y is not going to affect your belief in the value of x, provided the value of z is given to you. So if once you are observing z, then y is not going to affect the occurrence of value of x. So that is the conditional independency of x and y. Okay, so two random variables that are not marginally independent can still be conditionally independent. That means two random variables which happens to be dependent, then again we can see there might be conditional independency kind of notion would be there. Okay, suppose one example we are taking like this way. So one, there are three kind of event. One event is talking about battery is dead. Another event is talking about radio plays. Another event is talking about S is talking about a start turnover. So that starting, that tuning, there might be some starting instrument through that you can start the radio. Okay, so what is happening that if you see any two in together, those would be dependency. Radio plays, if radio plays and radio starts, both are having dependency. Likewise also we can see the dependency between battery is dead and radio plays. If battery is dead, simply radio will not play because there is a clear dependency because it is dead. Okay, so definitely radio will not play. So dependency between any two pair of the event, you can see dependency. But if you suppose information is given is that battery is dead, if this information is given to you, battery is dead, once battery is dead, then what will happen? R and S would be conditionally independent. If battery is dead, so there would be no dependency between R and S, that radio plays and radio start. There would be no dependency. Likewise, if you take suppose X is talking about height of a child, and Y is the number of words that a child knows. Okay, so these two random variable we are introducing. Then third random variable is coming Z, that one is talking about the age of a child. Okay, so if you talk about X and Y without having any information about Z, then X, Y, definitely we can say that there might be dependency. That means if the height of child is longer, then definitely that longer child may know more number of words. Okay, so clear dependency you can observe between X and Y. But suppose someone is giving information that the Z, information of Z is given to you. In that case, we can see there is no dependency between X and Y given Z. So that's where we can say that here X and Y are conditionally independent. So there are various examples in such kind of example we can talk. Like if you roll two dice, one may assume that two dice behave independent of each other. So there would be, simply you can see that both dice, whatever outcome are coming in two different role, it would be totally independent to each other. There is no dependency because both are totally independent, right? So that's why independency would be there by default. Okay, the result of one die will not tell anything about the result of die two. So that's why we are saying that the two roll of dice happens to be independent of each other. Okay, but suppose however the first die result is three, it is a three, and someone tells that you admit a third event or third kind of random variable, that one is talking about sum of the two result. So clearly you can see it here, there is a dependency because first one is three and it is given that this sum would be even. Then what would be, it depends, due to nature of three, the value of y would be decided. So what would be, if sum is 3, then being even, it must be what? Again, it is 3, that value of y must be odd again. It can't be even. So dependency, clear dependency is coming here.
So clear dependency here, simply we can say that here x and y, if you talk about x is talking about outcome of first, simply call it first dice, okay. First dice, and x, y is call it the outcome of second dice, then clearly both trial happens to be independent to each other. So there is no dependency, independency is there. But what is happening there? If you come up with a new random variable, that one is talking about sum is even. Sum is even. So due to that, easily we can say that now there is a dependency between x and y. But dependency, what kind of dependency? It is conditional dependency. Conditioning on z has introduced dependency between x and y. Otherwise, x and y happens to be independent. There was no dependency, but due to the introduction of this z, x and y are dependent. But what dependent? How? It is conditionally dependent. Okay. So other things we will discuss in next class. It is already above 45 minutes. Further, if you are having